Beautiful, isn't it? The only home we've ever known. But what if the only way to save the Earth was to push it somewhere else? Could we do that? Let's get technical. It is freezing out here. Life as we know it depends on 2 million septillion kilograms of mostly hydrogen and helium that forms an almost perfect sphere that we humans call the sun. And because we are so dependent on the sun's energy, life on Earth has a time limit. In a little over 7 billion years, the sun will have burned through enough of its hydrogen and helium fuel that it will move into another stage of its life, the red giant stage, and expand so much so that the Earth and all the inner planets will be consumed by just its radius. And that, as they say, will be that. How could we escape such a scorching fate? Well, that is the central question in the novella and recent Chinese blockbuster, The Wandering Earth. And that story's solution is to construct thousands of rockets taller than Mount Everest and just push Earth to another solar system. This would get us out of the way of a red giant, but is this even close to feasible? What kind of engineering would this take? Could we make a spaceship Earth? Let's begin with a simple case, using rockets to fling the Earth out of the solar system. The Earth goes around the sun more or less in a circle because we are gravitationally bound to it. To change where or how the Earth was orbiting then, something would have to fight against this constant gravitational force and add energy to the entire system. We are now describing gravitational potential energy, and the more we wanted to move something like a planet through a gravitational field away from a gravitational influence, like giving it a larger orbit, the more energy we would have to put in. But just how much energy would we have to put into the Earth's orbit in order to fling it out of the solar system? Well, if we gave the Earth enough kinetic energy to equal or exceed the gravitational influence of what it's bound to, the sun, by, say, changing its velocity, its orbit won't just increase and get larger, it will just fly off into the cosmos, never to return, always slowing down, but never falling all the way back into the sun's gravity well. So, let's set gravitational potential energy and kinetic energy equal to each other and do the math. We know the mass of the Earth, the mass of the sun, how far the Earth and sun are apart from each other, and we know Newton's gravitational constant. So if we solve for V here, we can get the escape velocity from an Earth-like orbit. Do this and you get an escape velocity for Earth from the sun of 42 kilometers per second, an absolutely blistering speed that could take you, for example, from New York to Los Angeles in just 95 seconds. The good thing, though, is that we do not need to get Earth moving at this ludicrous speed because we're already moving at an absolutely crazy clip. Do you feel like you're moving right now? Well, probably not, but you've always been moving. Since you were born, every single molecule of you has been absolutely racing around the sun, and because of this, you've never felt it. Earth's orbital velocity is already a substantial 30 kilometers per second around the sun, and so if we wanted to push Earth out of the solar system all at once, we wouldn't have to add 42 kilometers per second, we'd only have to add the difference, around 12, and then Earth would be on its way to Alpha Centauri. However, because the plan in The Wandering Earth, specifically an understandable plan, is to slowly push the Earth out of the solar system over the course of decades, we need to change the Earth's velocity by a lot more than 12 kilometers per second. In a slow, constant spiraling outwards burn, for example, where the sun is always pulling on you the entire time, you need to instead exchange all of this orbital velocity and kinetic energy for potential energy. You're spiraling outwards, getting further and further away from the sun, slowing down, 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 until you escape the sun's influence with zero, or thereabout 0 kilometers per second, and you have no orbital velocity because you are no longer orbiting. However we actually accomplish this, this all means that we would need to cancel out a full 30 kilometers per second of ancient orbital velocity to escape the sun's influence. Kind of like slowly getting off a cosmic merry-go-round when it's slow enough and safe enough to do so. And doing all of this would be the greatest feat of engineering ever attempted. In 2006, we launched the New Horizons space probe with a velocity that would take it out of the solar system. So we have done this kind of thing before. The problem with doing it with Earth is so dang heavy. The Earth is obviously huge relative to us, but just think about for a second, how much of Earth do we actually interact with? All of the forests, all of the oceans, every living thing you've ever seen, all of human civilization, all of the human experience has existed in a volume of Earth that is less than 1% of the whole. If we had to move the Earth to another solar system and we wanted to maintain some semblance of life as we know it, we couldn't just move 1% that is the biofilm that we call life. We would have to move 100% of Earth to maintain the biosphere, the geology, the magnetosphere, our gravity, everything. 100% of Earth is 6 trillion trillion kilograms, 6 with 24 dang zeros after it. And if we wanted to move all of this with some relative speed in some time frame, we would have to provide a lot of thrust, which would have to come from our rockets. Back of the envelope though, using a simple force equals mass times acceleration equation, the mass of Earth and the orbital velocity we have to cancel out, along with the time frame, let's say something like 15 years like the wandering Earth uses, we get a thrust value that has 20 zeros after it. That's a lot. So now we have to look up how our rockets stack up.
Slow burn, baby. No.
Now, the simplest way to, oh, still thrusting. There we go. The simplest, most straightforward approach to turn Earth into a spaceship would be to first stop the rotation of the planet, which would cause natural disaster unlike we've ever seen before, but let's ignore that for a second. Pick one hemisphere of Earth because we want the thrust point in one direction for pretty much the entire time, and then dot as much of that hemisphere as we can with rockets. These rockets would have to be engineering marvels like the world has never seen. And to get an idea of just how much thrust each one would produce, let's look to the wandering Earth again and say we use 10,000 rockets. If all of our Earth engines needed to add up to our total estimated thrust, then every single one of them would have to produce 37.
Wait a second.
Thousand trillion newtons of thrust. Crazy. And if we choose a pretty beefy boy in terms of thrust, like the Raptor engine from SpaceX, you can see that even though it produces a lot of thrust, it would still take billions of Raptor engines just to equal one of our Earth-moving engines. And all of these engines would take up a lot of space. Let's assume that because our scenario is a literal doomsday scenario, we as humans are willing to put as many rockets as we can possibly fit on one half or one hemisphere of Earth. How much construction, looking at this map, do you think we'd need to do? I have indicated here with a single dot a surface area required for a number of SpaceX Raptor engines. Not any of the infrastructure we would probably have to build around them, just the thrusty bits. Looking at this dot, how many other dots do you think we would have to draw on this map? Take a second to guess. I will wait. I will give you a hint. It's not this many dots. It's this many. Using current technology, the number of rockets that we would need to slowly push out of the solar system would literally cover every square inch of one half of Earth. Every square centimeter of ocean, every square meter of land, everything. Our wandering Earth then would have to look something like this, which is objectively super awesome, but shall we say totally and completely implausible. I think we need to go sci-fi. We would have to cover literally half the planet in rockets, so I don't think chemical propulsion is the way to go. So what about nuclear fusion? Oh, that's where that was. To its credit, the wandering Earth doesn't suggest that regular old chemical rockets are the solution to the Earth moving problem, instead stating that they use giant nuclear fusion engines taller than Mount Everest as their Earth pushers. And this makes everything a bit more believable, because one of the advantages of a theoretical nuclear fusion rocket is the speed at which they can throw fuel into the void. However, even if fusion engines could turn Earth's crust directly into fuel through the fusion process, even if all of these fusion engines could fit on one half of Earth, and even if they could provide the required thrust in total, fuel would still be a big problem. This may be the most famous equation in all of rocket science, the very cleverly named rocket equation. It is able to take what we want to change in terms of velocity for our spacecraft and relate that to the exhaust velocity coming out of that spacecraft, and how much mass we start off with and how much mass we finally end with. This change in mass is how much fuel we need. If we now give our nuclear fusion rockets an absolutely ridiculous exhaust velocity, thanks to the millions of degrees plasma created in these fusion reactions, then we can use our change in velocity we want to give to Earth to solve for what percentage of Earth we want to use as fuel. To move our spacecraft out of the solar system under all of our assumptions, we would only need to use 0.3% of its total mass in terms of fuel. But remember that our spacecraft is Earth. Let's remember that everything you know and love accounts for less than 1% of Earth's total mass. So in that context, this 0.3% number is more like 30% of everything you've ever seen. To power these futuristic nuclear fusion reactors, yes, we would only need to use 0.3% of Earth's total mass, but not all of Earth's total mass is readily available to us. So we would need to throw into these fusion reactors the equivalent of 13 times the mass of all the world's oceans combined. Even if we could make reactors like this and move Earth with them, we might not have the fuel to supply them or the ability to. And we don't even have fusion engines right now, nor do they seem to be on the technological horizon. Using current technology like SpaceX Raptor engines and the rocket equation, we could calculate that we would eventually have to throw the equivalent mass into space from our spaceship, which is Earth, of 98.98%. And if we had to do that, just to push Earth out of the solar system, just 0.02% would remain, meaning that everything, eventually, all the animals, all of humanity, civilization, plants, geology, everything, would have to fit on a spaceship Earth the size of a large asteroid. Because we'd have to use the majority of Earth's mass as fuel, just a few years after launching Spaceship Earth towards Alpha Centauri, we would run out of space for pretty much everything. The rockets, the animals, the plants, the food, us. I don't know if we want to make a spaceship Earth. So, could we turn the Earth into a spaceship to escape a dying sun? Well, using today's technology, we would have to make trillions of our best rockets and then move everything on one hemisphere of Earth in terms of resources to one side, and then dot that entire other side with rockets, literally every square centimeter, and then use so much of Earth as fuel that by the time we got to where we were going, we would be reduced to the size of not a planet anymore. Obviously, all of this is totally improbable, if not completely impossible. Using fusion engines would make everything easier, but space and fuel would still be a problem. For now, the only trip that the Earth will be taking around a star is another one around the sun. Because science. I'm taking this. And I should say, there's a lot of other ways that you can approach this kind of calculation. You can change the trajectory, you can change the engines, their orientation, the power requirements. But what I will say is that basically any combination of variables that you pick, it still is completely implausible to do. Either it would take you, with current day technology, like millions or billions of years to leave the solar system, and then it's going to be too late and you're going to be engulfed by the sun. Or the power requirement is so crazy for you to launch yourself out of the solar system like New Horizons that it's just something we probably won't ever create in terms of engineering. So that doesn't work so much, but the wandering Earth does get a lot right from having to slow down and stop the rotation of the Earth and population die-offs and all that stuff. It's pretty fun, and I appreciate the science in it. Thank you so much for watching, Teddy, and a huge thank you to Dr. Ethan Siegel and Matterbeam for their help on this episode. If you enjoyed this episode of Because Science About Spacey Stuff, you can check out some of the other videos that we've done, like what would happen if you actually pulled the moon to Earth like in Majora's Mask, and why you definitely do not want Superman to reverse the Earth's rotation. You can follow us at Because Science here on these social media platforms where I take suggestions for future episodes, and hey, thanks.